Okay, well, hello to Don and Bill, and thanks for being with us today. So we've got Don Smith, the one and only Don Smith, with us today. Don's the Senior Director of Cyber Intelligence at SecureWorks, and he heads up research and security operations in their counter threat unit.
Hello, guys. Nice to see you both in these strange times.
So, Don, you know, we know you've got a big track record in cybersecurity from CMS through SecureWorks to Dell to SecureWorks. So, can I ask you how you got there? Got to where you are now?
Yeah, it's kind of a bit of a random walk, really. I left university. I had a degree in statistics. Was a research associate for a wee while, and then grant funding ran out and I got a job as a computer officer back in the department where I was an undergraduate. And I'm sure no one will be too upset hearing this now, but that was back in 91 or 92, and there was a security incident, and that you know, we had a very early example of a breach notification from the old UKC, University of Kent and Canterbury, PSS gateway into Janet, which was X55 at the time, saying someone's coming in, there's UID 0. And I guess that kind of sort of triggered my interest in security. And for the next 8 or 9 years, whilst I was mainly an IT person, I always kept up the interest in security. And having transitioned to VBL, with sort of a vision group, the sort of well-known Edinburgh startup, got acquired by ST, and then I transitioned into full-time in security. And I came back from Geneva to Scotland in 2005. Graham Cox hired me into DNS. DNS was already a successful organization, having done quite a few interesting projects. 4 years later, SecureWorks came along and acquired us to kind of be their anchor point in Europe. And I guess the rest is just kind of the roller coaster ride it's been for the last 11 years, since 2009. And I guess I've moved from being an IT person to a controls person, where security was very much like IT projects, but with a security purpose, into a much broader, more general security professional. And then latterly, in the last 5 or 6 years, very much focused on the threat and the intelligence side, which is kind of a departure from where I've come from.
And that's your current role?
Yeah, I run the cyber intelligence cell within the CTU at SecureWorks. So it's our job to kind of understand what the bad guys are doing, whether they're hostile state actors or hardened Eastern European criminals.
Can we ask you what your first exposure was to computers? Maybe what was your first computer you had?
It was a ZX81, 1K of RAM. My father was a school math teacher and headmaster, and I said, we can have a 16K RAM pack. And he said, you can only have a 16K RAM pack when you can prove to me you can write a program which needs more than 1 kilobyte of RAM. So that was my mission. And a couple of weeks later, I got a 16K RAM pack. So, and I don't know if you can see, but there's a little stack of things over behind me. You can see a BBC Micro, and there's a ZX81 there.
I see the BBC Micro, yeah. That brings back some memories for me.
That's a very tricked out BBC Micro. It's actually got a Pi Zero connected to the tube port, which will emulate all the different tube co-processors. For those of us who are old, like Bill and I, we'll know exactly what that was, and that's cool. And for those who are a lot younger, you're not that interested, don't bother Googling it.
I remember all that. So what was your first programming language that you maybe used?
Basic. Basic, obviously, because of the ZX81 BBC, and again, computing history, the research machines, 380Z, CPM machine, which a lot of schools in Scotland at the time had one or two of those. Then when I went to Heriot Watt, the undergraduate teaching for people who were not computer scientists was Pascal, which is almost just like a language for teaching, I guess, most of the time. And then obviously when I graduated and started doing real things with computers, C and Perl, those were the two things that just well, has moved on, and everyone's using Python and Go and all sorts of other fancy things these days.
So yeah, you think a scripting language is probably the thing to get into if maybe our students haven't done much programming.
Yeah, and not just scripting languages, but being able to use the shell effectively. Even very recently, one of my team was trying to do something with a set of log files and was manipulating them in Excel. And I said, well, a combination of cut, sort, and a little bit of awk is going to help you here. So the power of the pipe remains, I guess, is what I would say. And a mentality that if you're trying to solve a problem, somebody has probably already solved it.
Yeah, totally agree. So we hear a lot about threat intelligence, threat hunting in particular, seems to be everywhere at the moment. Could you possibly just explain something about threat intelligence and threat hunting in particular?
Yeah, so the two are distinct things, obviously, and clearly linked when you get to the actor playbooks. You know, for us in SecureWorks, our primary job is to defend the networks of our clients. So that drives our intelligence requirements. So we have some very well-worn operational processes based around phishing, malware, other things that evolve in the threat landscape to make sure that we are capturing that flux and that we are changing countermeasures or any other forms of defensive controls we've got for clients. The key point there is it's driven by a set of priority intelligence requirements. Somebody else looking at threat intelligence might have a different set of primary goals, and they would actually find raw data sets to be of different value to us. And I guess I've kind of very quickly walked through what people refer to as the intel cycle, which is that you develop priorities, you think about collection planning, where you know your priorities give you the questions you're trying to answer. Collection planning gives you a focus on where you're going to find the raw data, helps you answer that. Then you need to get all your data in the right place, make sense of it, and then apply it somehow, whether that's written product that people can read to give them context, or whether it's a form of reputational databases, technical countermeasures, whatever. And I guess one way of looking at it, and the AI ML guys will shudder at my misuse of language here, but threat intelligence is a Bayesian prior for what you do when you're going threat hunting. So if you know what actors do, typically, you can obviously go and look for actors in your environment. Sometimes, you know, that's not a particularly cerebral task. You're just looking and saying, hey, have I got any hits to this you know, common C2 server for one of the banking botnets or droppers? And other times it's significantly more involved, where you're looking for the presence of multiple different things and saying, well, do you know what? If I see these four things together, then it means this. Threat hunting, though, is a bit more than that. It isn't just driven off your Bayesian prior. You really need, you know, threat hunting is a skill. It's not a process. And you really need someone who understands the mentality of the attacker, the tools an attacker can bring to bear, the strength and power of things like PowerShell, to try and anticipate and go looking in the darkest recesses of an enterprise to say, you know, can I find any evidence of things that look potentially bad, anomalous? And then the key skill is to not go down too many cul-de-sacs with that, because you will invariably find that some ropey installer is invoking PowerShell and doing something really, really weird that it shouldn't do, which looks properly bad, but hey, there's 12,000 instances across the client state, and you then realize that they've bought some software from somewhere that isn't particularly well packaged. So I don't know if that fully answered the question, but...
I think it's sort of, it's quite interesting, you know, I mean, being inquisitive, exploring, analyzing, knowing when to stop. I think those are key skills that come up again and again.
I think they do. And interestingly enough, obviously, having spent 2 or 3 years as, in effect, a computer officer, as you would call them back in the day at the Mass and actual Mass Department at Hewlett, where anything with a plug in it is something you have to fix, and that anything with a plug in it can be anywhere from a massively parallel transputer array down to something like a toasted sandwich maker. And that gives you a broad base on which to reflect when you're pursuing things. And interestingly, I hired a guy a few years ago from the NCSE. He'd been head of IR there. And his first job was as a computer officer in the University of Southampton. And he possesses that same kind of quizzical nature and the ability to fix things fast, but fix the right things, which I think that broad background helps with. Now, obviously, I'm bound to say that because it's my background and other people feel free to disagree.
I agree. So at Napier, we're quite interested, especially myself and Bill, in kind of applied research. You know, if we were to ask how we could kind of maybe better bring, you know, real life problems from industry, you know, closer or into research, do you have any ideas there?
Yeah, I mean, it's interesting. You chose your words carefully, Rich, in the question about applied research. And you guys do both applied and, in my view, actually quite pure research. And I think for academia, a balance is super important. I've said that bit, so that's my positive bit. And then I can kind of move on and say, well, you know, it does frustrate.
Cut the rest.
Yeah, it does frustrate industry at times that academia, for all the right reasons, kind of focus on the purer side of things, where there are some basic pragmatic things that most enterprises still get wrong. And, you know, it's just not that interesting to do, you know, 3 weeks of lectures on sensible approaches to asset management in your enterprise, or data classification policies, or whatever. So there's aspects of what we see from incident response. You know, our IR teams globally do about 1,000 reactive, so i.e. responding to incident jobs a year. And it is extremely rare, in fact, I can't think of an example, but I need to be careful with absolutes, for us to come away and say, oh, if only they just had this amazing piece of technology, a magic unicorn detector, they would have been fine. Generally, it's an acquisition that they forgot still had a network to the internet, or they hadn't bothered deploying multi-factor authentication, or they were unaware of you know, who was rolling things out, or they lacked policies on local admins, or whatever. These days, anyone can persuade someone in the enterprise to click on a phishing email. So that first foothold is relatively straightforward, and it's everything that happens after that, the layers of the onion, that I think needs some focus. I've spoken about this before, but needs some kind of ITIL with security. If I move away from the sort of, I guess, the fluffy side, there are things where an academic mindset could be brought to bear. Things like, we now have obviously the evil spectre of bulk droppers like Emotet, which are very, very present in the landscape. You know, there's lots and lots of Emotet infections always. And they can, with low probability, you know, turn into maybe drop TrickBot, and then TrickBot may be responsible for providing the reverse connect module, or someone then goes to use some host enumeration tools like Bloodhound and drop Ryuk. Ryuk obviously is post-intrusion ransomware, where you can end up with 30,000 hosts encrypted. And I keep thinking, you know, how do we predict from that initial Emotet infection that the playbook is going to, you know, go the direction of post-intrusion ransomware? Mm-hmm. And or how do we predict if it's not? If they're going to use some SMB scanning component to harvest creds and then, you know, sell those in a different way. And it's just a very interesting challenge to think about solving that problem, particularly in a world where we don't really have a clear view as to the human side of these actor groups. You know, the security industry, we're not SIGINT agencies. We don't have an understanding of how the criminal gangs are structured. We can infer it from what we see. So it is quite interesting when you see an initial infection dropped to say, right, you know, if this is a Markov process, what's the probability it's going in that direction as opposed to this direction? I'm not sure we maybe have all the data to answer questions like that. There are, you know, fun little data mining questions, which sometimes just because of force of pressure of the general flux of change in the threat landscape, you know, these are things that we would appreciate help from academia looking at.
I mean, that, yeah, that sounds like research. That sounds like dissertations and PhDs and very interesting, yeah, profiling threat actors and predictive models that...
The only downside is you don't know if there's going to be sufficient data there to actually come up with something which is a good story. So it could be it could be wasted effort, because when you're in the land of extreme values, you know, the percentage numbers of Emotet infections that turn into large-scale post-intrusion ransomware is tiny. But the impact is massive. And there you're in the world of decision theory, where you have something which is a mass infection can, with very low probability, have enormous impact on the victim. There's almost like the perfect storm of badness for network defenders to have to deal with.
I think for us, getting access to the right data sets is incredibly difficult. And some of the research published maybe uses data sets from industry, but doesn't publish the data set. So it's quite difficult to replicate. Yeah. So that takes us on to my next question nicely. So if there's one thing, if you can fix anything, if there's one thing you can fix in cybersecurity, what might that be?
Yeah, I think I touched on it earlier. Really, it's to encourage the people responsible for security to think pragmatically and tackle perhaps some of the less interesting challenges as well as the geeky technical challenges. Allied to that, we're probably coming through it already, but if we've gone, and perhaps I'm a product of this, through a couple of decades of where being a geek who understood security is a very good way to being promoted. When you do talk to boards at, you know, FTSE 100 level, which I've done a few times, you find that they are interested in risk. They have a very good understanding of risk, but to them it's business risk, and they don't really care about, you know, whether it was Emotet, TrickBot, ZeroLoader, QuackBot, IceID, or whatever that landed on their network. They want to know what the business impact is. And I think there's a second thing there, which we somehow need to work on, which is what is that career trajectory for someone who really understands the technical nuts and bolts to develop the vocabulary to be able to talk at the right level to C-level and to boards without their eyes glazing over, so they can get the right investment and influence. And that's not easy. And I should stress that I don't think these are different skill sets. You know, I think the fact that I still have a Unix box as my primary desktop, that I'm using VI every day, I can still hash together things in a shell, and I do go down into the weeds. Whilst my team would not necessarily agree with this, I think that that's a skill, and we need to make sure that we're building a breed of cybersecurity professionals that understand the detail, but also understand when to leave that detail out.
Yeah, so key skills, soft skills, communication skills, business language, risk.
Yeah,
I think that comes up a lot. So can you give us, for some students and our graduates just finishing, examples of some of the kind of interesting roles or jobs or kind of work, that SecureWorks do?
I mean, I think it's probably easier to list the things that we don't do, but if you think about the ways in which SecureWorks generates revenue, we describe us as having four key pillars. There's the managed services, which we protect people with, and that is evolving, because we are refocusing our efforts on promoting our software tools independent of our managed services. So I guess we have five pillars. I'm mentally picturing an old PowerPoint presentation in my head. We have consultancy, which is soup to nuts, from strategic down to very technical. We have threat intelligence, and then lastly, incident response, which of course is a form of consulting, but it's pulled out there because it's seen as something a little bit different. So if I look at the Edinburgh office, we have got people working in our internal CISO team. We've got people who are looking at the security of our internal software development and SDLC. We have got a fairly significant number of researchers. It's the largest single concentration of the research team globally, actually. There's eight of us. The research team itself is, I think, about 83 people at the moment. And I should note for the audience here, a quarter of that research team is in the UK. So we've got researchers. Obviously, there are software developers writing software products. We have pen testers, red teamers. Then we have the various different skills in the Security Operations Center, vulnerability analysis, device management, security event analysis, and threat hunting, incident responders. Not sure if we've missed anything out. And of course, we have, I guess, people who've chosen to make leadership their track in cybersecurity. So just across the microcosm of the Edinburgh office, we've probably got a swathe of skill sets there. Oh, and I'm going to forget, client advocacy, client service managers, which is a super important job for us. It might be one that is not regarded as massively interesting perhaps by students, but there's actually a great deal of, could I use the word joy, in being the person who is acting in that pivotal role between a large client and our services, making sure that we both get the best out of what we each have to offer and make that very successful. So pretty much you can name a skill set and you'll find that just in Edinburgh, down in Cannon Mills.
I think we've talked about this before, and I think sometimes it's hard to when you're looking to get into the industry, it's hard to picture routes through companies and the kind of roles you might get into. All you see is that job advert for maybe a kind of entry level job. So it's quite interesting to hear about the kind of options and routes.
That's right, and there is significant opportunity for internal promotion and transfer between teams. I guess that's one of the advantages we have when we're recruiting, is that we're rarely recruiting into a sort of dead man's shoes position. There's always opportunity within SecureWorks. There's always job openings. And whilst it can be painful at times if someone that you've has joined your team, that you've nurtured, chooses to move on, if they're not enjoying their current job or they feel they've outgrown it, having them move to a role inside the company where you don't lose that experience is obviously significantly better than that experience walking out the door after the investment you've made in the individual. So there are plenty of career trajectories that go from, pen testing to broad consultancy, or pen testing to SOC to broad consultancy, and then to the research team. And you guys both know Rafe, you know that pretty much is his trajectory. MSc from you guys, into the SOC, pen testing, broad consulting, and now he's one of the best researchers that SecureWorks has, full stop.
That's right. I need to speak to Rafe actually about a graduate story. Thanks for reminding me. So what advice would you give to our students kind of who are looking for that kind of first job, getting into cybersecurity industry?
Yeah, it's a good question. I guess
it comes back to key skills you mentioned already, a mixture of skills as well.
It does. I think there's a lot of things going on in my head right now. So as an example, some of my best security researchers have had the oddest degrees. I had one who, a first class honours degree in music, another who is an expert in archaeological metallurgy. And I think when you're 21 or 22, you come out of university, you've had a lot of focus in your life through various exams and stuff. I guess the one message is, and it's a hard message to pass, I think, is it doesn't really matter. Like, get some experience, show that you can do things in the work environment. And then, you know, 2 years down the line, wherever you've been, if you can craft a CV which talks about your academic prowess, and then in that two-year period at your first job, you can show that there's something you've taken ownership of where you can, doesn't need to be a big thing, and something somewhere where you've delivered, then that is the natural foundational Lego brick for employers, you know, both, you know, in any market sector, but also within the industry, to say, okay, this person's got something. And, you know, entry level jobs straight into places like SecureWorks, they are there. You don't get to come in and sit down and be a security researcher on day one. And there's actually a good reason for that. You know, we've had people join research team where you are expected to be 100% proactive. And they've just not been successful because they've been operating in a world which has been not purely reactive, but very reactive throughout their entire kind of career history. So there is a certain sense of an evolution there. Understand the problem you're trying to solve. Understand the foundational elements of that. You know, you can't offer advice on implementation of security controls if you've never worked with one and understood the pain of configuring one. You know, like, we'll all chuckle at this, but, you know, for every person that says a web application firewall is a fantastic thing, there's another person like me that says, yeah, but I bet a year in when I look at the policy, it's just a reverse proxy, because maintaining policies and WAFs is almost impossible as people tune their application. So, yeah, sorry, Rich, a bit of a rambling answer, but I guess it's just get experience and don't be overly worried about. Obviously, it's great if you get your first job choice right. You know, I didn't. I sort of stumbled around thinking, how can I continue to be a student? You know, and I just made sure that any job I was in, I did my absolute best, and it just seems to have worked.
Took me over 30 years to get into teaching. So, right. And just a final question for me for now. So being based in Edinburgh, what are some of your kind of favourite things about being based in Edinburgh?
Oh, everything. You know, it's easy to be, to kind of get used to Edinburgh. Obviously, you guys know our office used to be in Princes Street on the sixth floor. My desk, I could look out the window and see the summit of Arthur's Seat. No matter whether I was working late or working early or in the middle of the day, anytime you look up, there's someone standing on the top of that sort of volcanic plug or whatever it is. And walking from Waverley through the bit of Prince Street Gardens that tends to get churned up by the Christmas market, usually just the light bit different, and you just kind of look and go, there really is a large castle up there. And my goodness, that's quite an astonishing thing. And then even just taking US colleagues walking down through parts of the town, amazed at how old the city is. And that's before you get into the different festivals, whether it's the Science Festival, the Book Festival, or you know, the Fringe and the official festival. It's just a great city. It really, really is. And where our office is now, if I come out of the station, I do drive in typically, that's terribly lazy of me, but come out of the station, start walking down the hill towards Dundas Street, and you see the sea in the distance. It's just a really nice place to be. Really nice.
That's great. Yep, I wholeheartedly agree. Living just up the road from you there. So that's So I'll pass on to Bill for the next section.
Great. Well, I've observed virtually your whole career from DNS through SecureWorks to Dell SecureWorks, and then back to SecureWorks again. So you've probably seen virtually every single side of the industry, from the small 2-3 person team who are really struggling to get funding to the large scale infrastructure that you see now. Can you tell me a little bit about that story? Well, why are you still involved, and what was the peaks for you in that?
Yeah, it's a good question. Why am I still involved? If you look at my CV on LinkedIn, I've been with DNS / SecureWorks since 2005. which is a very long time in the security industry to be in one job. Key thing is, it hasn't been a job, as you've as you've highlighted there, Bill. Things have evolved massively from initially in SecureWorks. I was running the identity management practice. We were doing things like work with Sun and BT on the National Program for IT and the big identity management system that the NHS has in England and Wales, and many others. Then I became the kind of CTO of DNS, and I was focused on, okay, how do we build a portal for our customers? What about our next generation security event monitoring service? What about vulnerability management services? And then, of course, SecureWorks bought us. And again, the same thing happens. It's like, okay, well, we've got a couple of years where, you know, Richard Lewis and myself are very much focused on customer relationships. You know, are customers going to be happy to continue? Because we inherited a lot of customers from the Verisign MSS at SecureWorks bought almost at the same time in Europe. I moved into the research team, and initially my job was, as you well know, pretty much being, I hate the term, but an evangelist for what SecureWorks does. More recently in the last 4 or 5 years, building up the research capability, and then finally, I guess from 3.5, 4 years ago, being responsible for the core intelligence side of things kind of globally. So I've not really had the same job for very long. And even the job I have now is very different to the job I had when the cyber intelligence cell was formed. When we were formed, there was 9 of us. And it's quite easy to coordinate and motivate a team of 9 senior people. But there are now 21 of us in the team. And whilst I don't have to struggle very hard to motivate them, that's a different challenge to keeping 21 high value assets fully deployed to work on objectives. So, for me personally, the whole thing has changed along the way. And as you rightly observe, Bill, different pressures at different times along the way. I guess the most important thing for me is just as things change, as circumstances change, just continually reevaluate, am I applying my energies to the best place for the organization? I've never really had a plan ever. People who know me will be chuckling at this because they know fine that's true. But I've always managed to kind of like turn the tiller so that what I'm doing is being aligned in the best interest of the company. And like I say, it seems to have sort of worked okay. Very poor career advice, I think, for students. Just don't have a plan, just muddle around, it'll be all right.
Yeah. I think the great thing is that you were always on the end of a phone, or if we asked you to come up to the campus, you were there to kick the tires. So as we were going through our innovations and our spin-outs, that legacy of DNS with yourself and Richard Lewis was always there to really probe, but to see where we wanted to be and could see where we were and could see that route and could see the pain points. I think you've contributed so much. But along the way, you must have had your own innovations and your own things that you had a guiding light for and where you struggled to get these things over the line. What would you say were some of the things that you had a great belief in that really were difficult to sell from a business point of view, even though you knew there was a market there, you knew something there. What was the thing that kept pushing you back that you managed to overcome?
Well, I can give an example of one I didn't really manage to overcome. obviously, as I mentioned a moment ago, we were very focused on identity and access management in the DNS days. Who are your users? What have they got access to? Why have they got that access? What are they using that access for? And we've done quite a lot of very interesting projects in that regard. And SecureWorks was a much more threat-focused company. And if I was SecureWorks acquiring DNS now, I mean, the world is very, very different. But I guess in 2009, 2010, trying to persuade people that we should be continuing to invest heavily in identity and access management was a bit of a struggle. I think I even once wrote a paper saying that SAML was the protocol looking for an application. And of course, they very rapidly found an application because it's the glue that knits together SaaS applications and enterprises and absolutely critical these days. So maybe the idea was too early, but SecureWorks didn't invest heavily in identity services. And now actually identity is the perimeter. We have a, what's the fancy word you guys use? We have a software defined perimeter in SecureWorks. It basically means we've got a clever identity provider that is gating access to things and you know, making a compound decision, what we used to call adaptive access management, on where am I coming from, which device, which IP address, what time of day. The multi-factor auth I may give it is one factor in the decision as to what to let me have access to, but it's certainly not the only factor, and it may not be the primary factor either now or in future. So an understanding of identity and all these things is now absolutely critical for any security professional. And you know, I was made to promise a few years ago I should maybe to put my identity back down and not reflect on it. But yeah, I didn't manage to persuade people at the time that was something we should invest heavily in. So that was that.
Yeah. That's great. And you grew your company in Scotland. What's the good things about being here or finding finance and so on? And what's the negative sides of companies growing with inside Scotland?
Yeah, so I think... you guys know that when I was at ST Micro, one of my jobs there was assisting with merger and acquisition. And typically we'd be buying fabulous semiconductor companies in Silicon Valley. And it already struck me then, if I compared the funding challenges that Peter Denyer had with Vision Group, with VDL, listen, he went far too soon, but if I compare that to that whole game that goes on with the VC guys in the Bay Area, so it was very obvious to me, you know, back in 2000-2001, that the fluidity of investment funds in the US was several orders of magnitude different to Scotland. Also, the acceptance that that some of these things don't work. So your large portfolio of VC funds are making bets. They're intelligent bets, but they're still making bets, and they don't assume they will all succeed. And then you compare that to the landscape in Scotland, where there's much less cash floating around. A lot of it is in one way or another coupled to the government, but by no means all, as you know. And I think there's an expectation that everything must succeed. And that... Those things just create an environment where it is much more pressure on the innovator to make sure they have a product early, rather than a Lego brick of technology that could be, you know, attractive to be incorporated into somebody else's product. And you know, in the West Coast of the US, there are firms that will operate for a number of years without having to prove they've got customers. They've just got a chance to build that core capability. So it's very, very different. It's very different. I don't know really if there's an easy way of fixing it either.
Yeah. And let's say that you were given £10 million to grow a company in the UK to build that $1 billion company. Obviously in Scotland, we've struggled to create the Skyscanner type company, the high impact. If you look at ZoneFox, they were probably picked off just when they were really going to fly to be that big company. So if you had money and someone gave you that money, what business would you focus on to create that high impact, high growth company?
Yeah, so if it's high impact, if it's high growth, and you're looking at going from 10 million to a billion, then there's no option but to focus on product, because you need something that's going to scale, that can have a hockey stick. Anything that's services related, obviously there is, even though you can put in various things to help you with economies of scale, as you grow, you still are, there's a fundamental correlation between manpower and revenue, which is very difficult to escape from. So I guess that's the first statement in terms of narrowing this down. I should have given this some more thought. You did send that question to me. Is that it should be a product company.
What would that product be? What?
It's a good question. I once suggested that Dell shouldn't have on their homepage the concept of, do you want to buy a VMware software, an EMC array, or a laptop? But we should have a wizard that says, okay, so you're a businessman, what do you need today? Do you want to have an ERP system? Okay, so click here, next finish, we'll auto deploy your Azure Windows Active Directory, we'll do the tie up between that and whatever the flavor du jour of ERP system is, or Salesforce, or whichever SaaS app. But the legacy hardware manufacturers like HP and Dell and others should provide a kind of wizard driven set up your IT stack. And the advantages of that would be that you could definitely create playbooks for how you would set these things up and set them up in a secure way, so you don't end up with SE buckets floating around with little sieves of holes in their permissions, and you don't end up with not validating referrer URLs coming into your identity provider and all the rest of that. It's relatively easy for people to create these mashups between an enterprise SaaS application and identity providers. I think it's a lot harder to, again, without sounding like an old man, to go back to the old comp.risks and say, well, what's the overall system risk here? And I do think that some wizard-driven way of doing something like that could be fun. I don't know. I have no idea whether people would trust it or buy it, but it's just an idea off the kind of top of my head that I thought of once. I mean, Okta does a fairly good job of some of that. It's very easy to integrate things together in that regard. And I'm sure there's still plenty to... There's something there about a next generation SIM that is looking at behaviors rather than logs, where the subject of sentences is around behaviors. But we may already be doing that.
So what does the next 10 years of cybersecurity look like? If you were to put yourself into a teleportal and go 10 years into the future, what do you think you would see? How would the industry have changed?
That's a really good question, and I don't think I can look 10 years ahead. If I look back 2.5 years, I'm going to get years wrong here because they collapse on me these days, but I do remember warning people in the UK that this post-intrusion big game ransomware thing was going to be a thing, because we've seen a lot of it with a group that we called Gold Lowell in the US, and I think we've done something like 90 or 100 large-scale post-intrusion ransomware IR jobs in the last 18 months, 2 years. And when you consider that each of these is an enterprise that is completely knocked out, that's bad. As I said earlier, when you consider that the entry point is commodity malware, which most people find hard to stop, that's bad. And then if you look at the last evolution of the last, 4 to 8 weeks, where it's kind of like, well, pay up or we'll release your data. Or a double whammy, pay up to get a tool to decrypt the data. But secondly, pay up and we'll delete your data. I think the bad guys have finally worked out that they now have a balance to the pay up to get a decryption tool, which is pay up and release your data and unleash the hordes of GDPR on you and everything else that might come. I guess some of that could have been predicted, but I think what that means is that in the next year, 2 years, the level of risk, corporate risk associated with a fairly low level network intrusion, it's definitely got to be at board level. And that's going to result in a lot of focus on people who are trying to do their jobs. I think there's going to be a day of reckoning for technologies that don't actually help people stop stuff like this. At the same time, I think there's plenty of very, very good and competent security professionals who will just be unlucky when something bad will happen to their organization, and they'll end up being the fall guy. So I'm not sure where things are going to go, but I'm going to come back to the word pragmatic, where I think in 2 or 3 years' time, everyone is going to be asking the question about security controls that are deployed. Is it going to stop something? You know, is it going to detect something? Is it going to prevent something? With a much more focus than perhaps has previously been the case, where it may have been a slightly more academic control framework discussion. I think there's going to be enough people that end up being named and shamed by some of these ransomware gangs, or who have large-scale data breaches that can cause problems for them with GDPR fines, that everyone's going to be focused on, you know, stopping stuff. I'm not saying they weren't before, but it's going to be a much more pragmatic thing. And I think, sadly, as I alluded to, I don't think there's a realization at board level or at C level that the reason there isn't more of these things isn't because all the other networks are well defended. It's because there's only a finite number of bad guys out there. And so they're only chewing through the stuff they can get. So, I have a picture of Monk's the screen at the end of some of my presentations at the moment, where, you know, we have this, some of the most prevalent malware families we see, loaders like Emotet that can, as I said a couple of times earlier, with low probability lead to the most debilitating cybersecurity incident a company may ever have. And we need to work out how to get through that. And in 10 years' time, let's just throw something out there. Obviously, SecureWorks has gone software-defined perimeter. It works very effectively. I can get access to key assets from wherever. We did it last year. It's been an absolute boon during the lockdown. It's very, very easy for us to get access to key assets in a secure way. I think lockdown will have changed a lot of security teams, where they've realized they can do things quickly, that they can be the people that say yes, that they're the enabler for the business, rather than the guys going, no, you don't want to do that. That's insecure. So again, I think that in 10 years' time, we hopefully have a situation where security is seen as something that has allowed businesses to operate flexibly, rather than a bunch of guys who say no, sitting in a corner that no one wants to talk to.
And I think always talking to you, you could see the future. I remember talking to you about snorts and IDS systems and the way they could be used to identify signature-based analysis. And even then, you could see that security analysts were being swamped completely with all these low-level alerts. So how do you think the landscape will change in terms of that machine learning side? How do you avoid not dropping that really important thing, that small-level alert onto your system, and make sure that your human analyst can still cope with this?
That's a really good question, and there's a variety of different answers there, Bill. Obviously, the ML side of things definitely helps. I think you're aware that even historically in our older platforms like CTP, we were resolving around just shy of 50% of events using various different forms of ML models, which I'm not a particular expert on. I think, as I alluded to earlier, understanding the playbooks of the kill chain, so you can take discrete events and turn them into scenarios to present the ones that, you know, if I see these four or five things together, that makes a difference. When I was describing threat hunting, we obviously have a middle ground, which is that we look at those behaviors and we will create countermeasures for them so that our threat hunters have the time to be creative, because we're handling PowerShell dropping command at XA and then running a net command, you know, and that's bubbled up. And the last piece of it is just infrastructure indicators. And we are working hard at this. If you were to look at the historic Redcoat console, you would see things like, there's a PE file identified and executable. It would say, okay, across all PE files we have ever seen, ever, this is rare. We've only seen it once before or twice before, or we've seen it 22 million times, in which case it's probably, and it's on the NSRL, so it's part of Microsoft's distribution. So there's some very simple things you can do around just pure frequency analysis and rarity. And then I think the smarts come in teasing out what are the models that we can deploy that can self-learn around the telemetry that we have, because we've got a lot. It's well over a trillion logs a week. It was that at least a year ago, given our normal sort of rate of growth on these things. We're probably close to 1.5 or 2 trillion logs a week at the moment. We have a lot of data, and the tough thing that our ML guys keep talking about is finding good quality labeled data that can act as the seeds for the models. And that's obviously, without saying too much, an area that we are working extremely hard on.
Great. And Michael Dell, Bill Gates, and Steve Jobs all have had different viewpoints on our industry and the different routes and the different things. Which of those three inspired you most?
Oh, that's interesting. I'd be careful what I say here. Now you think Michael Dell on that list. Obviously, Michael Dell inspired me most since he's the chairman of SecureWorks. But each of them had something unique and interesting about them. You know, Michael Dell started to sell PCs direct. You know, that's kind of been lost in the ether. And he was the first person to really go direct. I think his first autobiography was called Dell Direct. And that obviously was a piece of vision and a focus. When I was buying a lot of computers in the mid-90s, when I was the IT manager at Vision Group, we exclusively bought Dells because they kept the spec the same. If we went to some other bucket shop, you'd find they had a different sound card, they had a different Ethernet card, a different motherboard or whatever, whereas at least if you bought a Dell Optiplex, you could have the same driver, and for those who remember the pain, the same config.sys, an autoexec.bat that would make sure that you could have a consistent golden image for these machines. So there was a professionalism and a robustness about what Dell did, which I think is something that we can all look to. Bill Gates, not a man that 20 years ago, when I was a dyed-in-the-wool Sun geek, I would have probably said anything positive about. But he is just the personification of, or his company is a personification of, kind of some of the things I've been saying about allowing yourself to evolve. You know, Bill Gates was the man who allegedly, although I don't believe he said it, the 640K thing, he certainly did say that the internet was maybe not a big deal. And yet, what's the mode of recovery for most people who get hit by post-intrusion ransomware? If they haven't already, they just flip a switch and they go to Office 365 because that's the fastest way for them to recover their enterprise. If you look at the portfolio of tools with Office 365 right now and the pricing tiers, now admittedly, this is all since he retired and he's now doing some fantastic work in terms of the Global Fund and other things. But there's an adaptiveness about Microsoft that if you'd asked me whether I thought Microsoft were an adaptive organization in the mid-90s, I would have just laughed. But they're adaptive and they're smart and they've been successful. And then you come to Apple, and I guess Jobs is the one that potentially I should align with more than any of them, you know, because when he got turfed out of Apple the first time, he decided to create the Next Station, which was, you know, an attempt to try and steal workstation revenue from both Sun and Silicon Graphics at the time. Both companies, I think, are now gone. So someone with a clear vision, but his vision was not so much driven from a technical perspective as more a desire to win, I think. And he clearly had some amazing innovation. When you consider, I remember Adam Lewis coming back from the States with the very first iPhone and showing us just zooming in and zooming out on a picture using a pinch movement. And we were just kind of, wow, you know, I don't know how much that was Jobs and how much was his clever hiring, and he was the burning desire to succeed, because I think that's what defines him. He also clearly had a personality that not everyone liked. A boss of mine worked at Apple for a while and had a couple of stories. But they all have their strengths. I've had to pick one. I don't know, maybe I'm going to surprise myself and say the adaptive nature of Microsoft and Bill Gates. I don't know.
Look at Richard's face.
I tell you what, there's a 25-year-old Don Smith somewhere that is absolutely taking in his grave.
DOS 3.0 and Windows 1.0, remember them? Right. So if you weren't into cybersecurity, what career do you think you would have taken?
I have no idea. I really have no idea. I think I've been lucky that I've been in workplaces and with employers and with leaders that were managing me that allowed me the scope to do what I wanted to do, which happily aligns with the company objectives. I think it would definitely be something technical, because I feel the need to solve problems and get the buzz of solving problems. But I honestly have no idea what it might be. Sorry.
Yeah. Well, thanks for all the helps that you've done through our innovation and really focusing our modules. We saw you grow. We saw you taking on our graduates. You were forever feeding back to us the kind of skills from a technical point of view that were really acquired, and you always inspired people at the conferences. You're always a great end note speaker. So I'll hand back to Richard, and maybe he has a couple of final questions.
A little bit off topic, but just wondering if you're a whiskey fan, Don, and if so, what would be your favourite, and how would you recommend someone getting into the whiskey? People always ask me, how do we get into whiskey? People are all, you know, students and people coming to Scotland.
That's a well-loaded question, Rich, and you know I am a whiskey fan. The last time we were at the Motley Society together, it was an expensive evening for me, mainly because I kept buying the bottles we were tasting. But I am, and I haven't always been a massive fan of whiskey, I guess. It was really bizarre. When I was travelling, when ST first bought Vision Group, I was flying to Geneva every 2 or 3 weeks for a while before I moved out there. And I actually just made it a policy of buying whichever was the litre bottle that was discounted at the Geneva airport when I came home. And then I realised that these things were all quite different. And that's what I love about whiskey. And I think I know that's what you love about it as well, Rich, is that you can go from something which is, which a lot of people would describe as close to undrinkable, something very smoky and phenolic and potentially harsh. And then the other end of the spectrum, you've got spirits which are ostensibly still described as Scotch whisky, which are very sweet and rich and like Christmas cake. And that's why I guess I don't have a favourite whisky, although I know on the coffee table downstairs from last night, there's a 16-year-old triple wood Balvenie, which is a very rounded and amazingly sweet thing.
Is that the 17-year-old one?
16, I think it is.
There's a 17.
Yeah.
And just having a look yesterday.
And I was shocked. I kind of found it. I'm sort of sorting the whiskey out at the moment in lockdown. I'm not going to state how many bottles I've got, but it's all a bit embarrassing. The thing next to it is the listening to the frog chorus. And I think the joy of old grain whiskey is something that is a new thing for me. And it's really amazing, actually. Going for some of these old grains. I'm sure that there would be a third bottle clump there, which would be one of the Isla ones, probably finished in a Pedro Jimenez cask because I like the edge taken off and roughness. But yeah, whiskey, just like try it.
Like a Lagavulin Distillers Edition type?
Yeah. If I had to pick a single bottle, that would probably be, if that would be my desert island bottle, is the Lagavulin Distillers Edition.
That's an interesting one. It's kind of smoky and interesting and got a lot to it, but it's also got that rum finish and kind of quite accessible. Yeah, I like that one too.
It's nice. I've actually uncovered two of the black label ones of those as I've been, well, as my other half has been emptying out cupboards. My kitchen was a bit like Whiskey Galore, where you could just open everything into bottles. And they're now all ended up in the dining room. And I've got three or four different vintages is a terrible word to use, whiskey, Don, don't use that. I've got three or four different labels of that Stiller's Edition. I should compare them at some point. But yeah, if anyone fancies whiskey, get yourself to the Maltless Society or somewhere like that. Don't drink too much of it. It's cask strength, and the bar staff know more about whiskey than almost anyone I've ever met in this entire planet. So just walk up to them and say, help me out, show me something interesting, and you'll definitely find something interesting.
Yep, that was excellent. Thanks a lot.
Yeah, we should go back post-lockdown.
Yes, we'll have to take you along, Bill. I don't think you've been. Oh, you're muted.
I'm missing the Edinburgh City Centre, and I just want to walk along Queen Street again. I really miss that kind of area. So thanks, Don, for the interview, and here's to many more decades of your leadership in cybersecurity. Thank you.
No, great catching up with you guys. Take care.
Okay, thank you.